So let's move on a little bit to talk about assessments, assessing clients or service users for wheelchairs. What sort of assessments are normally done in this setting? And what are the key points, or what are the main things that you would advise people who are interested in or who are already working in this setting to consider when providing assessments?
Okay, thank you. So I think a lot of people, probably the first thing that they think about are the measurements. You know, when you're thinking about providing a wheelchair, and most people will focus on make sure it's the right size. And yes, that is important. So you would do a physical assessment where you're looking at the person's medical condition or what their diagnosis is, and look at what their physical needs are. And it is important to make sure that you take the correct measurements, because you don't want to have a seat that is going to be either too long or too short, because that's going to affect the posture. It can affect pressure care as well. If it's too wide or too narrow, it will also affect the same things, posture and pressure care as well. Looking at things like you look at their physical ability. So for some people, they might need a bit more support in their wheelchair than others. So you've got somebody who might have really good core strength and they're able to sit up unsupported. It means that when you're looking at things like their backrest height, they don't need to have such a high backrest. If you're looking at somebody who probably doesn't have really good core strength and they're not able to sit up unsupported, then you need to make sure that you've got a backrest that goes up high enough to support them. For some people, they might need something that goes even further than just the backrest height. So they might need additional accessories put onto their wheelchair to make sure that they've got support for their trunk, that they've been held upright. They might need additional straps, pelvic belts, chest straps, shoulder straps. Some people might need to have a headrest because they might not have good head control as well. So that's looking at the physical element and more around the dimension. The measurements that you would need to take would be to make sure that you've got all of those factors into consideration, and you've got all the accessories that are needed and they are positioned correctly in your final prescription. Also, you need to think about pressure care. That's really, really important for somebody who does not have a lot of mobility. So it's important to ensure that you're looking at if they're at risk of getting pressure injuries, and you look at things like what's their mobility like. There's some people who would still be able, even though they can't use their legs and they're in a wheelchair, they might still be able to shift their weight while they're sitting in the wheelchair. But then you've got other people who would not be able to do that at all. So they'd be at higher risk of getting pressure injuries. Looking at things like their continence as well, looking at nutrition, looking at their whether they're obese or underweight. And one really important factor would be if they've had a pressure ulcer in the past, that would mean that they're going to be at risk of developing another one. So it's important that when you're prescribing equipment for them, you also ensure that you've got pressure relief. So the kind of cushion that you're prescribing for them is important. So those are the physical factors, but it's also important to look at the person's lifestyle and the environment. We are, after all, OTs, and that's the one thing that we, as OTs, we're looking at, a person holistically. We're not just looking at their mobility and getting them from point A to B. It's important to make sure that whatever we provide for them, it meets all their needs, their functional needs. So you would be looking at how that person's going to use their wheelchair, where do they want to use that wheelchair, what do they want to use the wheelchair for. Sometimes you might find that somebody, you might have like your gogo who's at home, who can walk with a walking frame in the house, but she wants to go every Sunday, she wants to go to church with her grandchildren, or she wants to go to the local shops, and she needs a wheelchair just to get her from home to the church and back again. That person's needs are going to be very different from somebody who maybe a young 28-year-old man who's had a spinal cord injury, who works full-time and is now a full-time wheelchair user as well, and needs to be able to get to and from work every day. You look at their home environment as well. You know, you want to make sure that whatever equipment you're providing for that person, it suits their home environment, but you also want to make sure that their home environment is suitable for the equipment that you're going to be providing. So sometimes you would need to go to the person's home and do an assessment of the environment in order to inform the prescription that you give them. Also looking at, when we talk about lifestyle, the type of wheelchair that you provide needs to be able to, you might have somebody who lives on their own, is very independent at using a wheelchair, you know, self-propelling, but they need to be able, and they can drive, and they need to be able to get into their car by themselves to transfer into their driver's seat. And then what happens to their wheelchair when they've transferred into the driver's seat? So they need a wheelchair that's light enough to then be able to be folded and dismantled, and then they can, you know, put that wheelchair into the car themselves. So there's a lot of factors that you look at. And I think it depends also on the context that you're working in, because I've worked in both low income settings and also middle and high income settings. And so you'll find that some factors are going to probably be followed or factored in more in high income settings, whereas others might be factored in more in low income settings.
It's quite interesting for me when we look at the OT focus. So it's not just about the physical performance components and having a right size of a wheelchair, but there are other factors that need to be considered, the lifestyle of the person, the environment of the person, in order to enable or promote occupational performance. I'm just keen to know, Lumbi, you have worked in low-income countries, middle-income countries, and high-income countries. And are there any differences in terms of the wheelchair needs across these countries? What sort of clients do you find requiring wheelchairs in high-income countries? What about in low-income countries? What about in middle-income countries?
I would say that there are a lot of similarities, and then I think the differences aren't really in the clients who require in wheelchairs, but more in just the amount of access people have to the right product for them. Or even to the service, because that's the thing, it's not just about the product, it's also about the service, which is something that, you know, when a lot of times in low income settings, what I've seen is people get products without the service that's, you know, required. And in high income countries, I'll start there, you'll find that they are, the number of services available for wheelchair users are so abundant compared to anywhere else. So in the other income settings, there either might not be any services existing at all, or there are very, very few services. So people will actually have to travel lots. If you remember in my introduction, I mentioned that when I went to Uganda, there were no professional wheelchair services in the country when I moved there. That doesn't mean that there were no wheelchairs being given to people. People were right. Getting wheelchairs, but there were no professional wheelchair services. So we set up for, in a country like Uganda, I can't remember what the population, I think, I'm not sure what the population of Uganda is. It might be over 40 million, if I'm not mistaken.
I know it's quite big.
It's a much bigger population than Zimbabwe, and it's got a much higher population density than Zimbabwe because it's a smaller landmass than Zim. Yeah. But if you think that four wheelchair services for a population that big, that's crazy, because you'll find that in each region, we didn't even manage to cover each region of the country. Like the whole eastern region of Uganda has no professional wheelchair services. So it means that where there are the professional wheelchair services, people have to travel long distances to be able to get there. And they might not even know that they exist. So there's also that awareness, it's not there. So there might be somebody who does need a wheelchair and they don't know where to go and get it. Whereas in a high income setting, you'll find like here in the UK, each county has at least one wheelchair service. Sometimes there might be more than one wheelchair service in a county, depending on how big the county is. You'll find that each person who's registered with a GP in the UK, and that's probably everybody in the UK, because in order for you to access the National Health Services, you have to be registered with a GP. That person is entitled to get a wheelchair service assessment if they need it. And so everybody who has mobility needs will at least get an assessment. It doesn't necessarily mean that they will get a product, or it doesn't mean that they might get the product of their choice, but there are options available for them. And they, even if they don't get it from the wheelchair service, there are other places that they would still be able to get that wheelchair. The other difference is in funding. And I guess that also ties in with the number of services. In the UK, the services are well funded. I'm sure if you ask people who are trying to access those services, they'll tell you otherwise, but they actually are very well funded. If you compare with the other countries that I've worked in, and the countries like Zimbabwe as well, I don't even know if there is like any funding for wheelchair services in Zimbabwe. I know in a lot of low-income countries, they rely on donations, from either NGOs. There's a church called the Church of Jesus Christ and Latter-day Saints, or LDS Church. They are very active in Zimbabwe when it comes to wheelchair provision. So a lot of the wheelchairs that you will find in Zimbabwe, they might have the logo Motivation on them, because they would have been manufactured by Motivation, but they would actually have been funded and sourced by that Latter-day Saints church. So a lot of NGOs are involved in provision of wheelchair services in low-income countries. And that means that there isn't always guaranteed funding. So whereas with the NHS, there's always like funding, there's a budget that's available for wheelchair services. So funding is always available, which means that it's sustainable. I was in Uganda for 2.5 years. If you go back to those wheelchair services that I was working with, they try their best, but they don't always have products available because they're relying on a donor to bring those products. So that's something else that means that services that happen in developing countries aren't very sustainable, and then it means that people don't have that access. It reduces the access even more. The kind of conditions that we see, it's the same spinal cord injuries. You see that across the board because people have accidents. People like stroke, children, a lot of children with cerebral palsy. Here in the UK, I used to see a lot of people with multiple sclerosis. I didn't see that a lot in the other countries that I worked in, and I'm not sure why that is, whether there's just a higher prevalence. Yeah, I'm not sure. The other thing that I also used to see a lot of here in the UK was motor neuron disease, which I didn't really get to see in other countries. Spina bifida, we see that across the board as well. The conditions, they tend to kind of like be the same, but I don't know why the neurological ones, a lot of the adult neurological progressive ones, I used to see more in the UK than I saw in the other countries.
I think it also follows the prevalence of these conditions across the populations. There are certain population groups who have got higher prevalence compared to others. So I think it just follows the same pattern. And also the issues of life expectancy could be another thing where you have, if the care is high, then people tend to live longer than in settings where there's not much care, where the life expectancy is actually shorter. So you wouldn't be having people with that condition over a long period of time.
Yeah.
Okay, so this now takes us to the next point of discussion. We've touched on assessments and factors to consider. Now we want to talk about the interventions now, the prescription and the sitting. What sort of clinical reasoning do you employ? What are the factors that you consider when you're doing the prescription and the wheelchair sitting and stuff like that, as well as the ongoing support?
Okay. I sort of maybe touched on some of these things earlier. When I was like just talking about when you're doing the assessment, the kind of things that you're looking at. So for example, the person's physical condition, you're looking at their diagnosis, and you're looking at their environment, lifestyle, etc. So if I give an example of, let's say, someone who has multiple sclerosis, and we know that is a progressive condition. you'll find that from the time that you first assess that person, whatever you prescribe for them at that point, you might have to review them a year later to see whether it still meets their needs. And this is very, very important. And I think that's another difference again between the two income contexts, where that follow-up that happens, you know, follow-up assessments, reviews of person's clinical provision, their prescription, it happens more routinely and more frequently in high income settings, whereas in low income settings, when we're training people, it's an important step in the wheelchair service provision steps. There are 8 steps that are set out by the World Health Organization. And the final step is that follow-up and repairs and maintenance step. And that is the step that tends to be overlooked a lot, because even by the wheelchair user themselves, all the other steps, they are very much involved in those. You can assess somebody and say to them, come back in 2 weeks for a further assessment or for us to fit you with a wheelchair. They will find the funds to come back until they've got their wheelchair. Then you send them away and you say to them, can you come back in 6 months for follow-up? They're not going to come back, because the thing that they wanted was the wheelchair. And they don't really understand the importance of, actually, this is a continuous process. It's not just, it doesn't end when you get your, product. We want to, your needs might change and we need to keep monitoring that. They don't really understand that. Or even if they understand it, there's so many other things that take priority. In a high income setting, because the funding is available, they will, we always make sure that we follow up people. So either they come back to clinic for an assessment, or the clinician will then follow them up at home if that's the need as well. So for example, that person who's got multiple sclerosis, you provided them with something, today, in a year's time, they probably are going to need something else. It might be that you're still keeping the same wheelchair, but you might need to provide a bit more postural support, make some adaptations to the backrest. It might be that the wheelchair that you gave them a year ago is now too heavy for them to push themselves, and they need a lighter weight wheelchair. And because the range is there, it's available, you could then step up to give them something that's a bit lighter. It might be that a year after the lightweight wheelchair, they now, their hand function has really deteriorated, and now they need an electrically powered wheelchair. And so you do another assessment of them, and these are all things that you sort of had to discuss with them as well when you first see them. So as OTs, we also do a bit of counseling with them for them to understand. Because sometimes when people are still mobile, they want to hold on to that mobility. And that's across the board. You find that people don't want to be in a wheelchair. There are very few people who actually would willingly be put into a wheelchair if they're able to walk a little bit, even 2 steps by themselves. And a lot of times you then have to do a risk assessment with them to look at, the risks that continuing to walk would have on their health. And you might have to then maybe get to a compromise where you say, okay, you can walk indoors, but when you want to go outdoors because the ground is uneven, etc., you need to use your wheelchair. And then, they get to accept the wheelchair at that point. And then once they've accepted that first wheelchair, you then also then need to have that conversation with them about the fact that, because of the progression of your condition, we might have to look at other types of wheelchairs as well in the future. So you prepare them for any changes in their prescription and help, it's a journey that they're going along, and you want to walk along that journey with them. That's somebody who's got a slowly deteriorating condition. On the other hand, you've got somebody who has motor neuron disease, which is quite a rapidly progressive condition, where when you assess somebody, they might still be able to walk with a frame when you first see them, but in the next 2 months, their mobility might completely go, and they might get to a point where even they've lost their hand function within those next 2 months. So when you're doing an assessment of that person, you can't assess them in the same way that you would assess somebody whose condition is progressing slowly or who has a very stable condition, someone who's had an amputation, but they're not progressing, they're very stable. So you'd have to make sure that whatever prescription you're making for that person, you're preempting what might happen in the future. You need to sort of like future proof your prescription and almost over prescribe for that person, so that you're kind of like you're being proactive rather than being reactive with them. But this is in an environment, once again, where you've got a range, a choice. You know, you can go for electric wheelchairs, you can go for wheelchairs that have tilt in space. You can look at different types of controls, not just a joystick that you use with your hand, but, you know, look at things like, you know, head controls, chin controls, using their tongue to control, those kind of things. However, come back to Tanzania, where we don't have any of those options. And, you know, you're now looking at very limited options. You might only have two wheelchairs that you can choose from for somebody who is living in Tanzania. And it's important that, it's still important to use clinical reasoning. This is something that I always used to like try and emphasize to my students, was that it's really important that you're wanting to fit the wheelchair to the individual rather than fit the individual to the wheelchair. And I know if you're in a high income setting, it's so much easier to kind of like stick to that principle. When you're in a low income setting and you've only got a choice between this wheelchair and that wheelchair, it's really, really difficult. But it's still important that when you're doing your assessment, you also make sure that you're applying the same clinical reasoning you would if you had 10 wheelchairs to choose from. So you look at all those needs that the person has, because the other skills that you also learn when you get trained to provide wheelchairs is to be able to like modify and adapt the wheelchairs. And you have to be really, really creative. And that's something that I learned when I was working in Uganda, is I came from an environment where I had, you could just walk into a warehouse or a workshop and, you know, take any, like a different type of headdress. Like you had like three headdresses to choose from or more even. And you could try them. And if they don't work, you can get like a rep over with a whole set of headdress that they can try with. And then I went to Uganda where there wasn't even a single headdress. And now you have to like, you know, adapt the one headdress that's there, or you have to make your own. And so you have to be really creative. And I think that's one thing that as OTs, we learn to be creative. It's one of the things that the skills that we learned. And I remember, I don't know if it's still the same now at UZ, but when I was there, we learned how to do like woodwork and leather work and APT and all of that. And those skills will come into good use when it comes to wheelchair service as well.
I mean, I remember those days when we were doing all those things. And at that time when we were doing that, we didn't see any reason for doing all those, but they really come handy, for example, in a low income setting for wheelchair services, as you've just put it across. Thank you so much for giving us those perspectives. I mean, there are other socioeconomic, sociopolitical factors that can actually come into play. I mean, the issues of occupational justice jump out of this topic, really, to say, I mean, it's not just a privilege for a person to get an appropriate wheelchair, but it's actually a right for them to get an appropriate wheelchair. But within the context of what is it that is available, what is it that the services can afford, you know? Right, so, I mean, from what you are saying, it's clear that there are stakeholders involved in wheelchair service provision. Can you maybe talk to us about some of these stakeholders and what are their roles, and how does the role of the OT complement what the other stakeholders do in ensuring provision of appropriate wheelchairs?
So I guess the most important stakeholder, I would say, is the wheelchair user, you know, the person that we're providing that wheelchair for. And it's important, I think, as OTs, it's important for us to be able to advocate for, you know, appropriate wheelchair provision, appropriate services. And like you said, I'm so rightly said that, you know, it's actually a right. It's a basic right for somebody to have an appropriate wheelchair. And as OTs, it's important for us to understand that ourselves before we can then be able to articulate it to other people and educate other people. And it's one of the things that I think I used to do a lot you come across a lot of people who are well-meaning, and they will, you know, provide, you know, it might be that they had a wheelchair for their grandmother. The grandmother died, and now there's this wheelchair that's sitting there, and then there's a child who needs a wheelchair down the road, and they're like, oh, I've got this wheelchair, you know, you can have it. And they've done well. However, it's important for us as OTs to be able to advocate for that child to get an appropriate wheelchair. You know, so the stakeholders are, you know, once again, depending on the income setting, they may vary. Some are similar. In a high income setting, you'll find that OTs, so a lot of wheelchair services are run by OTs. There might be physios in some wheelchair services, but mostly it's seen as like an OT centric profession. And that's actually the case in a lot of high income settings. In low income settings, I've seen it more the other way, that it's more physios, but I think that's more of a numbers game. It's just that in low income settings, you'll find that there's probably more physios who are trained than there are OTs anyway. So you'll find that, yeah, the OTs are the people who run the wheelchair services. Other stakeholders in high income settings will be, either other healthcare providers, hospitals, rehab centers, social workers, so social services departments as well, schools. So we've got a lot of schools, special needs schools here in the UK, and you'll find that wheelchair services will collaborate a lot with the schools. So with the social services, it's more around looking at the person's home environment and ensuring that that person's home environment is suitable for wheelchair use. So they've got, if they need adaptations done to their home, if they need to have ramps, etc. Sometimes they might need to have like a lift put into their home as well. So access is very, very important. And then you'll find that there's also charities that get involved as well, because the wheelchair service can only do so much. And there are times where sometimes you need to have a charitable organization then step in to then also supplement where the wheelchair service has not been able to kind of provide. And there are also other services that might be needed that are provided by charities, for example, day services. And then in low income countries, it's also, I think, similar, where you find that healthcare providers, so you've got your hospital, you've got rehab centers, CBR, workers as well. Community-based organizations, and they're very much involved because they're the ones who are living, working directly with the wheelchair user in their community where they live, disabled people's organizations, and also charities. I mentioned before the Church of Jesus Christ and Latter-day Saints. They're quite a big stakeholder when it comes to wheelchair provision in low-income countries as well. And I think as OTs, as I said before, advocacy. We have advocacy and, awareness raising, education. It's really, really important that we do that. And also that we're looking at, we understand, things from a functional perspective, and we're looking at it from a holistic perspective. Other people, other wheelchair providers will just be looking at giving somebody, mobility, giving them a set of wheels. But we are looking at that person holistically. So it's really, really important that we keep that at the forefront. We keep the user at the center, and we just make sure that we are looking at things from a holistic and a comprehensive perspective, and ensuring that we're saying the same message. We reinforce that message to everyone that we talk to. It doesn't matter whether they are, a charitable organization like, maybe an NGO like World Vision, a very big, powerful NGO, or if it's like an MP who's trying to campaign for elections and they want to take a whole bunch of wheelchairs to give to people. We have to make sure that we really pass that message, reinforce that message that wheelchairs aren't one size fits all. They need to be specific for an individual, and it's that person's, human right to make sure that they get an appropriate wheelchair.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that. I'm wondering if you can probably touch on the roles of the manufacturers. When you're with motivation, do they actually manufacture, or do they work with other manufacturers? And any your experiences surrounding collaboration between what OTs do and the manufacturers or suppliers?
Okay. All right. Yeah, I think that's really, really important because when you look at the World Health Organization definition of an appropriate wheelchair, I don't know it off by head, but one of the things is that it, you know, the design of the wheelchair needs to be, you know, to meet the person's needs. It needs to be a good fit for the user. It needs to be functional, and it needs to also be able to kind of be suitable for the person's environment. And this is really important because it's also something that I've seen in my work in international development, where once again, you have charities who mean well, and they will have wheelchairs that are maybe were designed for a certain environment, and they have a container of these wheelchairs and they want to ship them over to Malawi. And they really mean well because there are lots of people in Malawi who need wheelchairs. But unfortunately, the wheelchairs that end up going to Malawi from Canada or from England that were designed to be used in England now end up in, you know, Blantyre and Lilongwe and in the rural areas in Malawi, and they're not suitable for the environment. So they end up, like, you know, breaking and getting damaged, and they can't be repaired because you can't get the spare parts as well. And I think that's another part of the definition from the WHO, is that it needs to be something that can be maintained locally as well. So it's important that wheelchair providers, whether they are manufacturers or people who are going to buy from the manufacturers, ensure that they're making sure that the wheelchairs that they are taking to a certain context are fit for purpose for that context. As OTs, it is important for us because we are the ones who understand the human body. We've, you know, studied anatomy, we know biomechanics and everything else. So we understand, you know, what that, you know, the design element of the wheelchair and how that needs to be functional and ergonomic for the user. So we definitely have a role to play. And that's one of the things that I used to do in my role in Motivation, because Motivation also designs and manufactures wheelchairs. So we were, I still refer to Motivation as we, because I've only just recently left. But yes, we were actually very instrumental in the development of the World Health Organization guidelines for appropriate wheelchairs. And even the training packages that are there, the basic and the intermediate training packages that are now being used worldwide, you know, Motivation was one of the organizations that kind of influenced, pushed for that training and developed that training. And so we worked very closely with, you know, our design team to ensure that there's always like that clinical input that's put in, you know, that's taken into account when, you know, wheelchairs are being designed. And so that's another role for OTs. Every big manufacturer of wheelchairs should have an OT that works with them. So they'll have rehabilitation engineers, they'll have, you know, clinical scientists, but they should also have OTs. So they are in the high income settings, you've got companies like Invacare, you've got Sunrise Medical. So those are the ones that can, you've got Ottobock, you know, they will have OTs that actually work on their teams to ensure that, you know, they are actually, you know, making sure that they're taking into account the user's needs and making sure that any wheelchair that they design is suitable for that person's clinical needs. So that definitely is a role for us.
Wow. That, well, what are the pros and cons of working in wheelchair services?
I'm going to be biased here. I'm going to be really biased because it's obviously something that I'm really passionate about. It's something that I think for me, that's where I found my niche as an OT was in wheelchair service provision. And so it's something that I feel I would love to see more people, you know, going into it, because it is such a, it's such a specialist skill. People don't realize just how much of a specialist skill it is until they actually start working in it. Because once again, people see somebody in a wheelchair and they don't realize how much has gone into, you know, that person ending up, especially if it's appropriate everything that we've talked about so far in this interview, and you know, the process and all of that, it takes, you know, it takes ages to get to the point where from the person getting that referral to then getting a wheelchair fitted that's, you know, been appropriately assessed and prescribed for. So it's like a really, really, you know, high skill, it's a specialist skill. It's very interesting because you come across so many different types of people, and you know, you get to make a huge impact on someone's life. You know, I've seen people, and especially in low income countries, where you've got somebody who's never, you know, they'd be lying in bed, or you know, like especially like children with cerebral palsy, so they were born with a disability. They've never walked, they've never sat up, and you know, they've been lying in bed all along, and then for the first time, you get them sitting in a supportive seat, and they're sitting in that wheelchair, and they look around, and they look up for the first time, and they can, you know, they can make eye contact with people, and they're sitting at like eye level, you know, face to face with people, with their peers, and their friends are coming to pick them up and take them out, and you know, push them around the neighborhoods, and you can see that difference that you know it makes to someone's life. The fact that they were static and now they're mobile. Yeah. And you know, they weren't able to do anything, and now they're functional. You know, sometimes it means that that child can now go to school when they couldn't go to school before, and that wheelchair is the thing that's enabling them to then go to school. So inclusion, you know, it's such an important thing, because a lot of, you know, people living with disabilities are isolated.
Yeah.
And once they've got that wheelchair, and then you know, they feel more included, you know, in their community around them. And you've kind of enabled them to do that. It's something that's really, really rewarding. And I guess for me, once again, it's just being able to use your hands to do that, you know, because wheelchair provision is very hands-on. It's very technical. So, you know, so I guess for me, I sort of like enjoy doing that, because you can see the changes happening. You know, you can see you've done something, and you can see the outcome of what you've done. And the outcome can be quite quick, you know, unlike some kind of other rehab programs where, you know, it takes months. Sometimes it might just be the case of someone was lying down and now you've sat them up. And there's, you know, the rehab process is ongoing, but seeing that first result of seeing them sitting up, I find that really, really rewarding. I think maybe one of the negatives, which could also be a positive depending where you're looking at it from, because from a high income setting, OTs here tend to specialize a lot, so you'll find that a lot of OTs will go into specialist areas, and that's the area, because you go in there with very basic experience, not a lot of experience, and you only get your experience from working in that field. So once you start working in that field, you build up over years that experience, and you become specialized. And so that's quite good, because it means that you're unique. Nobody else can do what you can do.
Yeah.
No other OT can do what you can do, which, you know, kind of makes me feel special. I like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
However, it means that you are focusing so much on that one area and that one skill set that then you sort of lose the other generic, you know, skills, or, you know, and then you're stuck almost in that, you know, kind of, you're defined by that skill and that specialization. So I still call myself a wheelchair specialist. And I don't know, you know, maybe eventually I might end up, you know, moving away from that. But it's something that you might end up being defined by that specialism. And it might not be a good thing, because you end up being sort of like in a box. That might be a bad thing. It also limits your options. In the UK, it's quite good, because there's so many wheelchair services, so you've got options. But if you're somewhere where you don't have a lot of career options available, it means that if you specialize just doing that and not doing anything else, it then means that you're only going to be looking for jobs in that area, and it then means that you can't look for jobs in other areas.
Wow. Thank you so much for that. So now, as we are wrapping up this interview, since we've been talking about specializing, any words of encouragement that you might want to share with our OT students or other junior OTs who might be thinking of, oh, maybe I need to focus on wheelchairs. Maybe I need to specialize in wheelchair provision. Well, what would you say to them?
I think, like I said before, it is such, it's a unique skill, but it's a really important skill. We need it. I said earlier that we have a lot of wheelchair providers. We have a lot of people who are providing wheelchairs, but not enough people who are providing services. And that is really important. The service element is where we come in as OTs. You know, we have such an important role to play. And I think I mentioned before that in high income countries, wheelchair services are seen as more of an OT specific specialization, and they own it. You know, it's such a, you know, OTs will, who work in wheelchair services really own that space. And it's something that they're very proud of. And I think you could probably see it when I'm talking about it. It's something that I'm also very proud of. And I think it's important that, so I would definitely encourage people to, you know, look for opportunities. And I know in South Africa, sometimes there are training opportunities there at, it might be Western Cape Rehab Center, I think. So they do provide a lot of wheelchair service training. It's such a good skill to have, because it means you don't have to specifically just specialize as and say, oh, I'm just doing wheelchairs only. But it can help you in all your other practices of OT, because you're going to see people who need wheelchairs. Yeah. And you'd rather have the knowledge and the skills to serve those people appropriately than not have it at all. So, you know, don't feel that because I've trained as an OT, as a wheelchair, I've trained in wheelchair service provision, I must now be like patients and just specialize in that and stick to that only. No.
Yeah.
You can still use it to complement your other skills.
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Rumbi. Probably I was saying that was my last question, but I just feel like I just need to ask you one last question. Because, I mean, looking at your experience, you have worked in sort of like non-traditional settings for OTs. How is it like to work in an NGO or in charities, as we call them here?
It was like really interesting, you know, it's because that was my first non-clinical role. You know, I was employed as a clinician, but it was a lot of the stuff I was doing was more around project management and training. And so it was, I really felt out of my depth initially. And, you know, it was a steep learning curve for me because I was so used to being like hands-on clinical, having you know, my own caseload and all of that, and, you know, doing, you know, like hands-on assessments. And now I'm out there, you know, having to like, you know, mentor other people and set up wheelchair services when to be honest, I didn't even have a clue how to set up wheelchair services, because I was working in an already established wheelchair service here in the UK. Right. So, you know, everything was like really new for me and a lot of learning, but it was really great because for me, I thought that, you know, my going back to Africa, I wanted to go and like transform people's lives, but I ended up realizing that the biggest transformation that happened was like in my own life, because it made me see the world from a completely different perspective. And it just also, I learned a lot about myself as well. It gave me a lot more confidence than I'd had when I was in my traditional clinical role. I'm not saying that traditional clinical roles don't bring confidence, but for me as an individual, I needed to get out of my comfort zone and, you know, do something that was so outside the box that, you know, that would kind of push me a lot and challenge me a lot. And that really, really helped me learn a lot about myself and become more confident. And the passion that I thought I already had was multiplied. It really was. And you get exposed to a lot of things that, I guess for me, it was more seeing the difference between living in a high income setting and then going to a low income setting and seeing the differences in what's available for people and the access that's available. It was very heartbreaking for me. I used to really struggle with that. But I think that's where my passion came from, because I wanted to do more to try and kind of narrow that gap. And I know as an individual, you can't do a lot. but you do whatever you can, and that's what I'm trying to say.
I know we can go on and on this topic if we are discussing this topic because I know your passion, I mean, in terms of having services for people who need them the most. And I do hope that this is not the last time we see you on Motivate OTs. We will still continue to invite you to provide us with more insights on similar issues. And we know that you are going to be doing much more to sort of like help the profile of OT services, OT education in Zimbabwe as well, not just in the UK. Okay, so thank you so much, Rumi, for coming through. This brings us to the end of our session.
You're welcome. And I'm also happy to talk to people individually as well, if they would like to know a bit more about, you know, working in wheelchair services or the work that I did in the NGO as well. I'd be more than happy to speak to people individually.
Fantastic, fantastic. So there you've got it, guys. If you'd like to contact Rumi directly, you can still be able to do so. The easiest way of doing it is to just contact any of the staff members at the UZOT department, and they will definitely get in contact with us via the Motivate OTs platform, and then we'll be able to link you up with Rumi. Okay, so it's bye for now.
All right, thanks, Fungai.